beginning in verse 11, and we're going to read through verse 15. Would you stand with me? If you are able, if not, please remain seated. Acts chapter 16, beginning in verse 11. Let us hear the inspired and infallible and authoritative and necessary and clear Word of God. Therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothracia, and the next day to Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia and a colony. And we were in that city abiding certain days, and on the Sabbath we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made. And we sat down and spake unto the women which resorted thither. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple, of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, heard us. Please note that word "us" is in italics. It says literally, heard. Lydia heard, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. And when she was baptized, and her household, she besought us, saying, If ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us. Amen. May the Lord bless His word to our good. Holy Father, now we come before Thee after a blessed season of prayer, our hearts encouraged and strengthened. Lord, as our brother prayed earlier, I thank Thee for the praying men of this congregation. And Father, I thank Thee for the praying women of this congregation as well. And now, Lord, we do plead, as we have just read, Thou must open the heart. Wouldst Thou come tonight by that same grace and move in our hearts, open the hearts of the lost to see their need of Christ, their desperate condition, and send that grace to open the hearts of Thy saved ones to understand Thy Scriptures. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord Jesus Christ was pleased to send His servant Paul into the Roman colony of Philippi to preach the gospel. And it was a fruitful mission. Through the end of this chapter, Luke gives the longest record of Paul's mission work in any European city. Although Luke's focus in previous chapters has been Paul's evangelistic efforts in synagogues and towns, he now highlights Paul's encounters with individuals and their subsequent conversions. The power of God's kingdom and of Paul's preaching through the power of the Holy Spirit was clearly manifest in that pagan city. We first read of the conversion of Lydia, a seller of purple. Then, by the way, that means she was a wealthy woman. Then of the exorcism of a demon from a slave girl. And then the conversion of a jailer and his household. Now, in our text, we have seen that God worked a mighty miracle in the heart of this woman named Lydia. So the title of this message is God's Grace and Conversion. God's Grace and Conversion. And may our gracious Heavenly Father move with converting grace and sanctifying grace in our midst, in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the first thing we want to consider is this. We see the sovereign grace of God in the context of Lydia's conversion. Verses 11 through 13. Now, in verses 6 and 7 of this same chapter, we see God's sovereign purpose as the background of Paul's journey to Philippi. Now, when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia, after they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. Those are astonishing words. I wonder if many people that profess to be evangelicals know this verse is in the Bible. What kind of evangelism is that? Paul's heart is on fire. He's been preaching the gospel since the Lord saved him. And now he wants to go into Asia, and God says, no. He wants to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit says, no. That's astonishing. We must let this sink into our hearts. There are times when we might be on fire to take the gospel here or there or to that person, and the Lord says, no. I can tell you, brethren, there have been times when I've been praying and preparing a message and thinking, you know, this might be really helpful to so-and-so, or I hope brother or sister is there today to hear this, and they're not there. I'm amazed at this. Sometimes specifically praying for someone, and they're not there. How can something like this be? God is sovereign. He's sovereign. He's not trying to save anybody. He's saving. And he knows exactly where he wants the gospel to go and when and to whom. I don't know of a passage in Scripture any plainer than this. Paul wants to preach. And the Lord redirects him. Our sovereign God, through the divine guidance of the Holy Spirit, would not permit Paul and his companions to go into the region of Asia or to the peninsula named Bithynia. Paul's mind was fixed on evangelizing these places, yet God clearly had different plans. Weren't there lost people there? Yes. But the Lord said no. So, when Paul and his company entered the city of Troas, the principal seaport of northwest Asia Minor, a vision of a Macedonian man begged Paul, come over into Macedonia and help us. Come over and help us. In this remarkable vision from God, Paul and his companions were convinced that God had called them to preach the gospel in that country. That's why God forbade Paul to preach in Asia Minor or in Bithynia. There were sheep that needed to hear the Master's voice. And the Lord knew where they were, and He wanted Paul there to bring His gospel. That brings us to our text. Paul and his team left Troas and eventually arrived at Philippi. The text says, "Therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothracia, and the next day to Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi." Troas was a city. Samothracia was an island in the Aegean Sea. And so there was a long voyage leaving from that city and heading first to a regular stopover, and then they went to Neapolis, which was on the coast and about 8 to 10 miles from Philippi. Every single step of this was the will and with the guidance of God, the living God, the sovereign God, the Lord God Almighty, that ruleth, that reigneth over all things. Sometimes we're not clear exactly why the Lord redirects us or relocates us. But if we are His divine purpose is for us to serve Him in some way, to bring the gospel light to somebody. He knows where His sheep are. And there were some in Philippi. So, Philippi was a central city and a Roman colony in Macedonia. Besides worshiping Caesar, the people worshipped many gods. It had a large Roman population and very few Jews. In His sovereign purpose to save His people from their sins, God directed Paul and his companions there. Here in Philippi, the electing love of God would reach down into pagan darkness to save some of His people from their sins. He is always at work doing this. So Paul and his friends waited there several days, most likely for what we see in the next verse. Paul went to a woman's prayer meeting. Verse 13, the text says, "And on the Sabbath," probably why they were waiting, "the Sabbath, on the Sabbath, we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made. And we sat down." And by the way, that's the posture of teaching. Very often in our day, we read the scripture and go, they sat down. Must have been tired. Or it was time to just sit and chat. Now, this was the position. This was the posture of teaching. And they spake unto the women which resorted thither. Now, this was the Sabbath day, and apparently there was no synagogue in Philippi. Because to establish a synagogue, according to tradition, you had to have at least 10 Jewish men. Now, we don't want to jump to conclusions that are unwarranted, but it is interesting that it's women meeting. There are those that suppose that men were there, but then, of course, they have to spin from their imaginations as to why they're not mentioned. There are women gathered to pray at the riverside. It's the Sabbath, so these are likely Jewesses, Jewish women. Since entering synagogues and preaching the gospel was one of Paul's regular practices, he found the nearest thing. Now, there's argument among historians and commentators here that the words where prayer was wont to be made, the Greek word there is not the word regularly translated synagogue, but it comes from a Greek word that is sometimes applied to synagogues. So, it is quite possible that when it says they were gathered near the river, that this was a building in which they gathered to pray. Some do suppose that it is a synagogue, though there are others that would argue no. So they may have been inside, they may have been outside. That's one of those details that's not given to us clearly, because it's not the point. The point is that these women had gathered to pray. And since it was the Sabbath, we may assume that these women were Jewish. Nevertheless, God-fearers or proselytes to Judaism regularly met with Jews, and we see that in Acts 13. There were Gentiles who went through the process of being what we call proselytes. They joined themselves to the Jews and eventually worshiped the God of the Jews. So that's another thing we're not sure about. It seems most likely that she's a Jewess, but it's hard to know. We just know that it's a woman named Lydia by the side of the river who's gathered with other women to pray. She worshiped God, it says. So that brings us to consider Lydia. First of all, God's sovereign grace brought Paul and his companions to a riverside over 150 miles away from where he originally wanted to go to talk to a woman. And number two, we see the sovereign grace of God in the work of Lydia's conversion. The sovereign grace of God. In other words, when we say sovereign children, we mean that God rules and that He rules over all things. He is the great King, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the absolute ruler of heaven and earth. Nothing happens anywhere in the universe without His knowledge or apart from His ruling hand. Nothing. He's sovereign. When we say sovereign grace, we mean the grace that He shows according to His rule. And the object of it, in this context, is Lydia. The inspired word says, "And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul." It's quite interesting that Lydia was from Thyatira. And where is Thyatira? It's a city in the region of Asia Minor where God forbade Paul to evangelize. And in God's sovereign providence, their first evangelistic effort involved this woman. Lydia was a seller of purple cloth. That was a luxury item in those days. And the fact that she had a house large enough to lodge the apostle and his companions, and as Acts shows us later, a congregation met there, it points to her obvious wealth. Now we have to consider something, and it's this. Lydia was a worshiper, but not a convert to Christ. This is a subject that so often appears in Scripture. I know that some of you think that I just harp on this all of the time. It's because it's all through the New Testament. In fact, the Old Testament is as plain. There are people that embrace religion, and don't know God. This is a subject. And I'm sure that some of you wonder why it appears so often. Why? And the fact is this. One, religion is a natural part of human existence because we're made in the image of God. It is the natural bent of all human beings. Secondly, it appears in Scripture as often as it does because Satan gets more mileage out of religion than anything else. And that's a very sobering thought. Isn't it interesting that the very first evangelistic work of Paul in this city is to a religious woman, not a harlot? Why isn't he down in the red light district? Because religious people need Christ. Perhaps even more than those who've never heard his name. Why would I say something like that? Because religious people think they're okay with God. And the women walking the street aren't kidding themselves about what they are and what they're doing. Christ himself could say to the Pharisees, the harlots and the tax collectors were considered the absolute scum of the earth, go into the kingdom before you do. So it's quite interesting to me that we see this about Lydia. Again, we don't want to read too much into what's going on there, but what's plain is that she is the object of God's glorious, sovereign, saving grace. Without the glorious grace of God, we will worship in the dark. We'll worship something. We'll worship ourselves if there's nothing else. So to speak, worship in the dark, so to speak, unless the illuminating and regenerating grace of God fills our hearts. So, God's transforming grace opened her heart. That is glorious. This is thrilling. Brethren, we don't see the miracle of the open heart set before us anywhere in the Scriptures any plainer than this. We don't have to guess what's going on here. The text is extraordinary. And a certain woman named Lydia heard. Well, there were other women there. What? Didn't they all hear? Well, they all heard with their ears of flesh. But only Lydia heard in the way that Paul is using the term, the way Luke is using the term. Whose heart the Lord opened. And that's why she heard. Why did she hear Paul? The Lord opened her heart. It couldn't be any plainer. She heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken by Paul. We don't know how many women were there, but we know one of them attended, fixed your mind on, responded to what Paul preached. And there is one reason. God opened her heart. This is amazing grace. This is exactly what John Newton meant when he said, "Amazing grace that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found." Not, "but now I found God." That's the way human beings think. But what the scriptures are plainly teaching us here is that God found Lydia. And he opened her heart. And she looked to Christ. She believed what Paul said. Now, we need to get real. We've all heard of Christ the Savior. We've all heard that he's the God-man. Well, I trust we all have heard that. Anybody that's been here very long has heard that. You've heard that Christ is the God-man, the eternal Son of God that became flesh and came into this world, who died upon Calvary's cross, a criminal's death, and rose again the third day, ascended up into glory. He is seated in a place called heaven where he rules at his Father's right hand. And he's coming again to take his people to himself. That sounds crazy to people that have never heard that. We've all been inoculated with American Christianity enough that this is not new or unusual to our ears. But go someplace where they've never heard of Christ and tell them that a dead man is now alive, ruling the universe. Come on. Think. None of us have ever seen the dead rise again. And he died as a criminal. His reputation. Well, then he was a troublemaker, put to death. And you're telling me this is God that I need to bow down to? Think. Get out of your American brainwash and try to imagine people that have never heard any such thing and being told, "Your eternity rests on what I'm telling you about this dead man that's alive again. And if you don't repent and believe, you will be lost forever in your sins." Does that really make sense to you? But Lydia heard. She heard what Paul had to say. And she believed because God opened her heart. This is a miracle. John Newton was so wretched and so wicked that as the captain of a slave ship, when he fell overboard, his crew harpooned him to bring him back up into the boat. This was a wicked man. And yet, he wrote the hymn that probably, if anyone has ever heard a Christian hymn, has heard. God found me in my sin, just like he found Lydia. And as he found any of us that are genuinely converted. Well, this is one of the clearest scriptures in all the Bible that reveals that conversion is a work of God's grace. Conversion is a work of God's grace. Notice the order. Lydia was listening. The Lord opened her heart. She paid attention. She responded to Paul's message. As I said at the beginning of our series on conversion, Regeneration is God's act alone. But conversion is a work of God and men, God and people. It begins with God. But when God acts, people act. They repent. They believe. And they follow Christ. That's what we have here. This was a glorious. That's a word that doesn't really hit a lot of us anymore. But this is glorious. Weighty. Rich. Glorious. Supernatural act of God's grace. Her conversion was not because she was smarter than the other women who were gathered there for prayer. It was not because Paul was so persuasive. He was handsome, looked good in front of a camera, preached, and everyone went, "Oh, wonderful." He wasn't a celebrity. Hardly. It wasn't because Paul quoted the Reformers and the Puritans, or because his sermon had three wonderful, well-thought-out headings and a verse from a great hymn. Paul told the Corinthians how he preached, and we should take careful notice. And all of us that preach should. My speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. That's how Paul preached. He wasn't trying to impress anybody. Hey, you can tell by the way I preach, I've read some good books. Well, you can hang that up. It's good if you do that. It's wonderful. God can use it. But you've got to know God's Word, and you must preach in the power of the Holy Spirit. Because it isn't our preaching as such that saves anybody. It is the glorious grace of God. Paul faithfully preached the glorious gospel of the grace of God in Christ and trusted the power of God alone. This is crucial. The living God sent him over 150 miles across the Aegean Sea to gather some of his elect in Europe. This fulfilled the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember that he said, "I have other sheep. I have other sheep which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." The other sheep are the Gentiles. Brethren, we ought to love that verse. It's the only reason we're here. Not because we're Jews. We are Gentiles. We're the other sheep. And God in His mercy found us, and He opened our hearts like He opened Lydia's. Oh, my brethren, all of the women gathered for prayer heard Paul's message, but God opened Lydia's heart, and she believed what that man was saying. I've had people come up to me over the years and say, and quote back to me lines from one of the sermons that I've preached. And I thought about it. I was like, yeah, I think I said that once. And I said, well, the Lord opened my heart with that. Why? Well, it's the Lord. It's the Lord. We bring the truth about Jesus. And we trust the great and holy God who opens hearts opens hearts. Brother, we ought to be praying with all our hearts throughout the week. Lord God, come by that amazing grace and open hearts. Open hearts that people will attend. And brethren, as I said, even those that are regenerate need God to work in their hearts. You can hear the best preaching in the world and remain spiritually inert. A terrible place to be. The preaching of God's word ought to be transforming, changing us, challenging us, making us think, and provoking our hearts to love for the Lord that manifests itself in obedience. This is conversion, and it's evidence of conversion in those who profess to be Christians. This is remarkable, is it not? Paul had desired to go into Asia and preach Christ, but the Lord sent him to turn a woman by the riverside, quite a distance away, from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God. She repented of her sin and believed that Jesus was crucified. She believed that Jesus rose again from the dead. She believed that Jesus ascended into glory and that He's ruling and reigning and that His kingdom will eventually overtake the entire world. Here in this passage, we see conversion laid bare. There it is. What is it? It begins with God opening your heart. And then you hear. And you repent. And you believe. Well, you know, when I was in the fifth grade, I walked the aisle and prayed a prayer with the preacher. I'm okay, right? Not necessarily. Well, my mom and dad were wonderful Christians. I'm okay, right? Not necessarily. We've had children sit here and grow up under the preaching that you hear all of the time and still actually believe that they were okay because their parents were well known and served the Lord here in this congregation. Children, you're not saved because of your parents. You are converted when you repent of your sins and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. So we need the Lord actively moving in the hearts of our children. Well, God opened Lydia's heart and she responded to the words of life. Thirdly, then, having considered this wonderful passage, we want to take a general principle and run with it a little bit. We see the sovereign grace of God in all true conversion. What have we seen in this passage? Paul, the appointed apostle to the Gentiles, the hand-picked servant of Christ, the risen Lord knocked him down on the road to Damascus, hijacked him from his religious life and brought him into the glorious life of the kingdom and said, now I'm going to teach you all the things you're going to suffer to serve me. And when Paul is fired up to serve his Lord and wants to go to Asia Minor, the Lord says, no, up here in Macedonia. And we see one step after another until he arrives at a riverside outside the city of Philippi. And here a group of women. And the Lord opens the heart of one. That's the sovereign grace of God. Where were you when the Lord dealt with you? Where were you? What were you doing? When you had no idea, but the Lord was putting people's feet in the path, or however, whatever medium He got that truth to you. You didn't realize it. You weren't even thinking about it. But sooner or later, God got that truth right in front of you. and you heard. That's the grace of God. Now you might have, I mean, what's troubling is when you're like the only one in your family that's believing. Bunyan so beautifully paints that in Pilgrim's Progress. He has to stick his fingers in his ears and run away from his family saying, life, life, eternal life. If God opens your heart, you cannot but serve Him. You cannot but desire Christ. You just come sit in a church building and go, yeah, I'm okay. You're in deep trouble. This is a life of following hard after Christ. And it begins because God reaches down into our darkness, whether we're religious or not, and opens our heart to hear the truth of Christ, to believe Him, and to follow Him with all of our hearts. We're not perfect. We fail. We still sin. But we can't live there. We continue to look to Christ and get up to walk with Him. We have turned and we continue to turn. We see our sin, we fall in our sin. The Spirit of God shows us and we turn again. As I said early in our study, in a certain sense, Christians are always being converted. We've all been so brainwashed by decisionism that we think, well, there's just one cataclysmic moment when I've turned and that's it. Well, we understand that what bit of truth there is in that idea. But the idea is that the Christian, of course, turns to Christ once in that glorious work of conversion. But throughout his life, he's always turning from his sin and turning to Christ. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying he gets lost and then saved and then lost and then saved. I'm not saying that. But there's always the recognition of what our sin is and turning to our Savior. So, the psalmist proclaimed, thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. And that's exactly what we see in Lydia. She's willing in the day of God's power. So we see it in this remarkable passage through and through. Paul opened his mouth. God opened Lydia's heart. And Lydia opened her mouth in faith. God revealed His Son and Lydia received His Son. So, first, all saving knowledge. All saving knowledge of Christ begins with God opening the human heart. When Peter declared Christ, do you need a distinction on that? When I say all saving knowledge, you can hear about Christ, and many of us here did long before we were converted. I'm talking about saving knowledge. When you come to believe, like Lydia, what you've heard. When Peter declared Christ to be the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus said to Peter, flesh and blood hath not revealed this unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Peter had been walking with Christ for quite a while. Somewhere along that journey, he came to believe that Jesus was the Christ. I'm not saying he fully understood even what it meant to say you're the Son of the living God. But he had an idea about it and a belief in it that brought blessing from Christ's mouth. Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. It wasn't flesh and blood that taught you that. The disciples themselves could not understand the Scriptures until Christ opened their understanding. Luke 24, 45. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the Scriptures. This had been the men that were walking with him all along. But as he sent them into the world to be his representatives, as he sent them out into the world to preach the gospel, he opened their minds to understand the Scriptures. Brethren, do you pray throughout the week, oh God, when we come together, come by the power of thy Holy Spirit, open our eyes, open our hearts, even as thy dear children, to hear and understand what you're saying to us. Why? So we can do it. So that we can obey thee and walk with thee and bring thee glory. We want to be transformed. I mean, you know, don't come with your pad and your list of, okay, well, let's see. No, I guess on Sermon Audio, that sermon would be about a 3. You know, that's what we're here for. The weakest and most pathetic of fleshly vessels can bring the words of life. God opens the heart. This doesn't mean we shouldn't study. It doesn't mean we shouldn't wisely put our words together in an attempt to communicate God's truth clearly. But that doesn't change or open anybody's heart. God must be at work. Pray. Pray that He will come. Pray that He will rend the heavens and come down. Pray that the Spirit of life will seek out those that He's known and loved before the foundation of the world. And open their eyes, open their hearts, open their lips in repentance and faith. It's right here. This is, of course, is why Jesus said, no man can come to me. The language there could not be plainer. No man is able to come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him. I don't know what could be plainer. You could hear the angels speak the truth. You could sit under Spurgeon or men that preach greater than Spurgeon could have imagined. You won't believe. You won't leave those sins that you love. You won't leave that life that you're holding on to with a death grip. You want to be cool. You want to be respected. You want to be thought of as urbane, educated, smart, cool. But when God opens your heart, you will respond to the truth about Christ. And that truth says, if any man will follow me, let him take up his cross and deny himself daily and follow after me. We need the Lord to open our hearts to believe that. Is that not so? I mean, Jesus said, no man will come to me. No man can come to me. It's not possible except the Father draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It's written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught of God. Every man, therefore, that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh unto me. Does that mean that God comes down on a great cloud and reveals himself a mighty image of flaming fire and begins to teach you, and then you become a Christian? No, not like that, but that is what he does. He does teach you. How does he do it? In his word and through the mouths of his servants. God speaks. God speaks every time one of the brothers comes behind this pulpit and faithfully teaches from this word. God is speaking, not the vessel of dust. Let's be clear. But this is what he does. God teaches. God teaches the human heart to come to him. That he has to open that heart or we'll never come. We'll never come. So all saving knowledge of Christ begins with God opening the heart. Secondly, all saving knowledge of sin begins with God's gift of grace. When God opens the human heart, as he did Lydia's, this is an act of great grace. God does something, and we respond and do something. This is why Spurgeon's Catechism, question 70, says, repentance to life is a saving grace. This is not legalism. Repentance to life is a saving grace whereby a sinner, out of a true sense of his sins, understands what he is. He understands that he's broken God's law. He understands that if he dies in those sins without being forgiven, he will perish eternally in hell. He understands it. He senses he's in trouble. Oh, I did something that my mother told me not to do once. I'm sorry, children, I have to admit this. She was going out of town. I was in my college days. Something she told me not to do, and she and my dad went out of town on vacation. And the day before they came back, well, she told me not to have anybody in the house, and I had a couple of friends over. And they came home a day early. With my friend, it was my friends that greeted them. I had gone to the back for something, and I heard the door, and I heard their voice. It's difficult for me to describe to you how I felt. But I can say it to you this way. I knew I was in trouble. I'm in trouble. I was in trouble. And for days, my mother couldn't look at me. Except when she did, she would fasten her eyes on me. I would try to joke. I'd try to tell her what was going on with my day. I tried to tell her what I was learning at school. It didn't matter. She would look at me, and I was in trouble. And it took her a while to forgive me. Boy, I felt the weight of that. I felt the pressure of that. I sensed my sin. This is what the Catechism is telling us. You know that you are in trouble with God. He's not Santa Claus. Oh, God loves everybody. Read the book carefully. He is love. Oh, we never deny that. Praise the Lord for it. But he's also holy and just. That's why it says repentance is a saving grace whereby a sinner, out of a true sense of his sins and apprehension of the mercy of God in Christ, he senses his sins and understands and senses the cure for that horrible disease, sin. And it's the Lord Jesus. There's that turning, the negative part. I changed my mind. And I turn and I see the mercy of God to one like me. Well, the Catechism goes on to say, it does, with grief and hatred of his sin, turn from it to God with full purpose to strive after new obedience. This is a good definition. Now, we hear this, though, from the Jews right here in the book of Acts when they heard Peter's report of the conversion at Cornelius' home. They said, after hearing Peter defend himself for going into a Gentile's home, what did they say? Then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. God grants repentance. It's all of grace. Salvation is truly all of grace. And finally, all saving faith in Christ begins with God's gift of grace. It isn't that I didn't have something else to say. It's the very fact that I want you to understand that conversion is made up of repentance and faith, and both are the gifts of God. Paul told the Romans, it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. Similarly, John said, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. The sons of God! Even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh. Faith and repentance are acts of the will. Telling us right here, we weren't born of the will of our flesh. Not born again. Of the will of our flesh in and of itself. We don't force God to do it. We don't make God do it. Listen. Listen carefully. Which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man. Somebody else can't even do it for you. They can't wish it or will it on you. But of God. That's how it ends. How is it that we are born and believe so that we become the sons of God? God in His mercy births us. He opens our hearts just like He did with Lydia. Paul told the Ephesians, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." It's that whole thing there. Ye are saved through faith. That's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Lest any man should boast. Luke says in Acts, and some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which when they were come to Antioch, spake unto the Grecians, preaching the Lord Jesus, and the hand of the Lord was with them. The hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed. It's just right there. And turned unto the Lord. This is conversion. Change of mind that leads to a change of action, a change of life. When Paul was disposed to pass into Achaia, the brethren wrote, exhorting the disciples to receive him, who, when he was come, helped them much which had believed through grace. And Paul told the Philippians, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. It's given to you to believe. Brethren, I find it shocking that some of the most arrogant, cranky people I've known were people that believed the grace of God. When if you understand what we're talking about, you should be the humblest people breathing God's air. It means that if you know Christ where you sit tonight, just like with Lydia, God put someone or something on the path to find you where you were and bring you the truth of Jesus Christ. Paul said to the Thessalonians, but we are bound to give thank always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. Sanctification of the Spirit there means being set apart by the Spirit. Lydia was in a group of women, and God came by His separating grace, sanctifying grace, and opened her heart. And she believed. This is the outworking of God's eternal purpose, the glorious covenant of redemption, the very things that we've talked about so often. This is God at work. And when He's at work, when He has sent the Spirit to seek, like a heat-seeking missile, the Holy Spirit comes after God's people and opens their hearts, and they repent and they believe, and they can't understand why the people around them won't. Why do you believe? and others in your family despise what you believe? Why, when you were converted, did some of your friends kind of find someone else to hang with? Why can't they see? They don't want to see. They don't want the life that you're now living. And you wouldn't either, except Christ opened your heart. And you believed the truth, and you turned from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan to God. Is this clear? Well, this is the last thought to give to you. We see this very outworking of election in repentance and faith when Paul preached to the Gentiles in Antioch, Pisidia. It says, "And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad." They were glad at the good tidings that Paul was preaching and glorified the word of God. The Gentiles, right? The Jews are arguing with him. They're fighting him. They're resisting what he's saying. And the Gentiles love it. They're eating it up. Why? Well, it says this, "And as many as were ordained to eternal life believed." Jesus was gathering his other sheep, and he's been doing that in every generation, and he's done that here, and he's doing that around the world. So, brethren, in our desperately wicked condition, we need radical transformation, and that transformation is called conversion. It is our act. We repent. We really repent. It is our faith. We really believe. But it's all because in God's grace, He's opened our heart. And that turning begins in the sovereign grace of God. So may He have mercy upon us. May He have mercy on our children, our city, our nation, our world. May He continue to pour out the glories of His amazing grace, drawing His sheep out of darkness into His glorious light. God's grace is the heart of conversion. Amen. We thank Thee, Father, for Thy goodness and grace. Take these truths, please, please, please. Gracious, almighty God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Moses, God of David, God of the prophets, God of the apostles, Peter and Paul and the rest, and our God, and the God of all Thy dear sheep down through the ages and in all places of the world. O God, come and move in our little place. May we know Thee here. May there be wonderful conversions to Thy glory and the eternal good of Thy people. In Jesus' name, amen. Brethren, let's stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Now to Him that is of power to establish you according to My gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but is now made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. To God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. Let's go in the name of the Lord.